India continues to break global coronavirus records, and the spike is crushing its public health system as oxygen, hospital beds, and even cremation sites remain desperately scarce. And as President Joe Biden touts his vaccination record to Congress, his chief medical advisor, Dr. Anthony Fauci, is calling out the U.S. and other wealthy countries for failing to tackle the global nature of this pandemic. And now, almost 150 religious leaders are launching a global campaign to end vaccine nationalism or extreme vaccine inequality. In a joint statement, they say, "We cannot abdicate our responsibilities to our sisters and brothers by imagining that the market can be left to resolve the crisis or pretend to ourselves that we have no obligation to others in our shared humanity." One of those faith leaders is Dr. Thabo Makgoba. He is Southern Africa's Anglican Archbishop, and he's joining me from Cape Town, along with Seth Berkley, who is CEO of Gavi, the Global Vaccine Alliance, which supports immunizing poor countries. He's in Geneva. Gentlemen, welcome both to the program. Can I start with you, Archbishop, because you and your fellow faith leaders of all different religions have signed this letter and this urgent call. You know, up until mid-April, apparently only less than 1% of people have been vaccinated in sub-Saharan Africa. Can you tell me from your own eyes the urgency of the need on your continent?
Thank you, Christine, for having us. The urgency is indescribable because if one looks at the COVAX system and its intention, it's supposed to help the global south and the poorest of the poor countries to vaccinate only 3%. It is destined to fail. And in my context, I've seen people die without saying goodbye to their families. And if one looks at the scourge in India in your introduction, one is anxious that should we have that magnitude in the continent will be wiped off the face of this earth, whilst others are hoarding. So this is not a moral issue only, but it is an issue of greed, and it is an issue that the world should really speak up and stand up against such behavior in the face of death, particularly when monopolies are wanting to make capital instead of saving life.
Golly, Archbishop, when you say wiped off the face of this earth, it's a really dramatic picture and it's a dramatic crisis. So let me ask you, Seth Berkley, you know, according to the WHO, I think only 2% of COVID-19 vaccine doses have been administered in Africa. And of course, their population represents 16% of the world. And we've been reporting on this inequity for months now. And as the Archbishop said, rich countries are hoarding. You're concerned with the, you know, with the poor nations and the poorest people. What can actually be done? Promises are being made from the highest levels of power. We've heard President Biden himself.
So thank you, Christiane, for having us and for taking on this important issue. The numbers are terrible. I mean, high-income countries, about a third of the citizens have gotten one dose. In the lowest-income countries, it's 0.2%. Clearly, that is not equity. Now, why was COVAX set up? It was because, you know, this something like this happened in 2009 in the last epidemic, and we wanted to try to do something else. But as the Archbishop has said, what's happened is there have been export bans, there have not been sharing of doses, and this has been a real challenge. So COVAX has been able to procure over 2 billion doses, which will be available by the end of 2021. That should cover 30% of the population, but they're not here today. At the same time, wealthy countries bought more than 1.5 billion doses beyond the amount they need to cover their citizens because they didn't know which vaccines would work. So what we're asking is that right now, at this critical time, they share those doses so that we can make sure that at least the healthcare workers and the highest risk groups get served everywhere in the world, because we're only safe if everybody is safe. And that's the reality of this pandemic and the new variants and the spread that's occurring.
You know, you talk about how healthcare workers, of course, should get vaccinated. I was stunned to hear a WHO official in Africa today say that it's heartbreaking to watch on television or whatever, as she put it, a 19-year-old in a rich global northern country receiving his or her vaccine, where health workers, you know, who are on the front lines of this pandemic in Africa or India or wherever, cannot get even a first dose. So, Archbishop, you, with this letter, are calling, in fact, on the world's most developed leaders, the most powerful G7 leaders, who are coming here to Britain, I think it's in June. You're calling on them to make this a priority and to really get every piece of this puzzle towards sending vaccines to where they're most desperately needed right now. Do you think your message is going to get through?
I'm hoping this message, and through your programs and many other voices and people of faith and no faith, the G7 will listen. Because look at it this way. I was working in Lesotho over the weekend, and I had my mask, and I had to do the testing because I was crossing the border. And lo and behold, at a hotel where I was staying, there were more people with an American accent and an English accent, and they are here. So the pandemic and the coronavirus does not know color. It does not know race. It does not respect the national flags. And I hope that the G7 will realize that we cannot vaccinate in Europe and think that the variant that comes from other places in India and everywhere will not reach their borders. And we are only safe if everyone is safe. And I want to say also, I mean, Canada is one of the G7, and I was pained that Canada also used the COVAX. Yes, of course, they can, but use the COVAX in the first instance to buy so many vaccines. I would have thought Canada would say, let me go and compete with the others, or let me support the global south to really access more vaccine rather than take vaccines. But to those G7 leaders, please examine your conscience. We are safe together. This is not an apartheid issue where you are driven by capital and monopoly, who have already made their profits. Think about life rather than profit.
And of course, at the beginning, that was the pledge, wasn't it, Seth Berkley? It was going to be, you know, intellectual property was going to be shared, the patents, it wasn't going to be about a profit-making motive. I'm stunned to hear that Canada would have accessed vaccines via COVAX, which is meant to be, I thought, for the developing world. Seth, how does that happen?
Well, actually, Christiana, the way COVAX was set up was to try to avoid these bilateral deals. And the idea was to have global solidarity and have equitable access. So we invited all countries to join, wealthy countries, you know, upper middle income as well as low income countries. And for low income countries, we were raising finance to make those vaccines available free of charge. The challenge we've had is that because so many doses were locked up at the beginning, we haven't been able to get doses in the first half of the year. We have a large number of doses, as I've mentioned, for the second half of the year, but obviously we have to oblige the people who have put money on the table to buy doses, and we keep our promises and we'll do that. Of course, we are encouraging countries that have large amounts of doses to make those available, as well as the companies to go ahead and serve the international market at the same time they serve the wealthy markets. That is really the challenge that's in front of us. The last thing I'd say is that We worked hard to get technology transfers, a lot of them to India. So the doses that are being used in India now are being doses that were being made to be used around the world. Of course, we understand the need. And so we're trying to diversify to other manufacturers to make sure that, you know, we have enough producers around the world to make the doses that are necessary.